Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Anybody ready for the word of the Lord today? Awesome. Awesome. Get your Bibles out. Get a hold of them. You say, I forgot my Bible. Get your phone. Most phones, you know, if you got a smartphone, you got your Bible on your phone, get that, whatever you need. Otherwise, start bringing your Bible. We'll put it up on the overheads for you today so you can follow along. You got it. Stand to your feet if you have the ability. I'm going to get down on my knees and let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Father, what a joy it is to be in your presence, God. We just rejoice with the joy of our salvation. It's so good to be in the house of God today. Father, we celebrate your goodness, and Father, thank you for what you've already done in this place, healing many. And so we praise you and thank you for that, Father. Lord, we don't want to stop there, God. We want to go farther with you. We want to go deeper in our experience and our wisdom and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So today, God, as we open up your word, we pray that you would open it up to us. Open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Truly today, Lord, we acknowledge that the Holy Spirit is the teacher of the church, not a man or a woman, not the young or the old, not the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. It's about us coming together and hearing from you. So welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need, Lord. We'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel. Lord, they're our brothers and sisters. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building one kingdom, and that's yours. So God, we bless all of our brothers and sisters. Bless the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals, God. We thank you for Calvary Chapel, Harvest, Oak Valley, The Well, The Way, for Ecclesia, for Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God, for the Four Square Denominations and Victory, God, for the Assemblies, Lord, for our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord. If they're preaching your gospel, lifting up your name, God, we bless them as you would bless us. Lord, we don't just bless them, God, as well. Lord, we remember our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the world. We ask that you would protect them, provide for them, bless them, and encourage them, God. May they endure to the end. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement, and we say, amen. Amen. Also, I forgot one group of people to mention, but I want to welcome those of you that are joining us online. Thanks for joining us. I believe God's going to speak to you as well, wherever you're at across the nation and around the world. God is good. Today, get your Bibles and go with me to Hebrews the 11th chapter. We're going to be in two verses, verse number 11 and verse number 12. Verse number 11 and 12 go together. Last time we were together in the book of Hebrews, you remember Pastor Luke brought a great message about Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 11, talking about that we can trust in God and stand on his word. If you go back to about Mother's Day, I believe Pastor Deborah and Pastor Jess brought some truths out of this amazing message about Sarah. And so if you want to refresh on this verse number 11 and find out more about that, you can go back to those two messages. Don't worry if you missed them. Today's message stands on its own, and you'll be right where we're at today, and you'll get something from the Word of God. The title of today's message is this: The Beautiful Paradox of Faith. The beautiful paradox of faith. Now, a paradox is something that seems contradictory, like a statement or something that you see in life, and yet it can exist together. Even though it might seem like it couldn't exist together, it might seem like it's contrary to itself, but it can exist as it is. In our Christian walk, there are many things that we see in the Bible that is a paradox. For instance, in order to even enter into life with God, you have to die in order to live, right? That's a paradox. How about this? The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. That's a paradox. We don't understand that. We say, how can that be? Is the line going to be standing this way, and all of a sudden God's going to tell everybody to turn around, and hey, I was in last place, but I guess now I'm in the front of the line. What is that all about? And yet God says that's a paradox. He's really talking about servanthood, and that as we humble ourselves, that we become great in the kingdom of God. It's something that seems contradictory, and yet it still is true. We're going to see a paradox of our faith here in Hebrews, the 11th chapter. Let's read verse number 11 and verse number 12. Take a look at it with me. It says this. It says, by faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Now stop right there for a second before we go into verse number 12. Here we see the paradox in Sarah's life. She is past the age of childbearing, and yet here she is, and she receives strength to conceive seed, even though she was past the age. Now let's take a look at verse number 12. And it, verse number 12 starts out with one word, therefore. That therefore is there for a reason, we've been taught, right? The therefore says, in other words, because of what I just said in verse number 11 about Sarah, about her receiving strength to conceive seed, because she judged him faithful who promised, therefore from one man, that man being Sarah's husband, Abraham, right? From that one man, and him as good as dead, were born as many as the stars of the sky in multitude, innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. So here again, we see the same paradox in Abraham's life. This one man was as good as dead. Remember, he was 100 years old when they had their son Isaac. Now, yesterday, our convalescent hospital ministry went out into 16 different hospitals in the Inland Empire. I would venture to say, if one of our wonderful volunteers that went into the hospital went up to one of the people that was staying in that place and said, hey, are you thinking about having kids anytime soon? They might say, you're crazy. I'm thinking about what I'm going to do this afternoon, but I'm not thinking about kids. That is long gone. That was a time that I'm well past. I've got grandkids and great-grandkids. Ain't no way I'm going back to that. And yet here's Abraham and Sarah, that when they received the promise of God, they were 75. Abraham was 75, Sarah was 65. 25 years later, now they have the promise. When they were past the age, Abraham was as good as dead, and yet here are two dead people now bringing forth life. That is a paradox as we look at it. In fact, if you turn with me to the book of Romans, chapter number 4, it describes more about this. Romans, the 4th chapter, turn there with me. And Romans, the 4th chapter, talks about the nation of Israel who is looking at the law versus the spiritual seed of Abraham who's now coming in by faith and by grace, okay? That's the context of what this is talking about. But within that context, it starts to talk about how Abraham had faith, believed God, and received the promise and was able to have a child. Romans chapter 4, we're going to start in verse number 16, and we're going to read through verse number 21. Romans chapter 4, starting verse number 16, says this, therefore, it is of faith that it might be according to grace, so that the promise might be sure to all the seed, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. Now stop right there for a second. Really what that's talking about, you remember when God gave the promise to Abraham, he said, so shall your descendants be, as numerous as the sand which is on the seashore and as the stars which are in the sky, right? Now we know that that is a twofold promise. It's talking about the same thing, innumerable descendants. But the sand on the seashore is the natural descendants of Abraham. In fact, if you read out throughout the history of the Old Testament, when it talks about the nation of Israel and how they grew, it says that they were innumerable as the sand which is on the seashore. See, that is the earthly natural seed of Abraham on the earth. That's why the Jews were able to say Abraham is our father, because their lineage came, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and then the patriarchs, and now the nation grew out of that. That's the sand which is on the seashore. But then Galatians tells us in the 3rd chapter that now by faith, the Gentiles have come in and we have become children of Abraham, who is the father of us all by faith. That is like the stars of the sky. It's a spiritual thing. It's a higher thing. Are you listening today? So that's really the context. That's what we're talking about today. The promise is now fulfilled in us. Verse number 17, as it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. In the presence of him who he believed God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things which do not exist as though they did. I like how the old King James says it. We often quoted, God calls those things that be not as if they were. See, that's quite a paradox for us. And yet when we are introduced to God, Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1, in the beginning was God. Nothing else but God. And here is a God, and there's nothing, and God speaks like be and like was. Something that had never been before. God speaks and planets exist. God speaks and the vegetation comes out of the earth. God speaks and God creates with the words of his mouth. That's the God we serve. Goes on, verse number 18. It says, who, speaking of Abraham, contrary to hope. You know what that means? Abraham had no hope. In the natural, he could not have a son. He had no hope with the natural circumstances. And yet, contrary to that, contrary to hope, in hope, believed. In other words, he heard the word of God, and even though he looked at his natural circumstances and said, hey, this is dead. I'm an old man now. This is not going to happen in the natural and the physical. In hope, he still believed God, so that he became the father of many nations, according to what was spoken, so shall your descendants be. Verse number 19, look at this. And not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead, since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb. There it is again, talking about how these two people who were as good as dead, who were past the age of childbearing, now were able to receive that strength. Verse 20, he did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God. See, Abraham had to stir himself up. He had to rehearse and remind himself of the promise. God spoke to me. It's going to happen. It's going to take place. I have a promise from God. He said that my descendants shall be as the sand on the seashore, as the stars in the sky. He had to stir him up. He had to praise God. He had to thank God. He had to give glory to God. And that's no different in our lives. We got to hold on to the promise. We got to rehearse the promise. We got to remind ourselves. You got to write it down. You got to get it in front of you. You got to see it. And then you got to praise God and thank God for it on a daily basis. God, I thank you. You're going to bring it to pass. You're going to make it happen. God, I don't know how you're going to do it. God, I can't see it in the natural, but God, I know that you're a supernatural God and it's going to take place. Verse number 21, and being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform, just like Sarah, as we saw in chapter 11 of Hebrews, verse number 11. See, he was fully convinced. You say, but wait a second, didn't Abraham laugh? Didn't Sarah laugh at the promise of God? Yeah, they may have laughed the laugh of unbelief at first, but once they crossed over into faith, now they were waiting for the last laugh, that laugh of joy that receives the promise of God and says, oh my goodness, I didn't know how it was going to happen, but guess what? God is faithful. God is awesome. God is great. God did it on my behalf. God is so good. And you lack the laugh of faith now. See, that's where Isaac comes in. Isaac means laughter. And in our lives, there's a laugh that's coming to us who believe God. Now, with everything we see, there is a God part and there is a man part. There's 100% God's ability and God's working, and there's 100% man's ability and man's work. See, it's not just God. This is not just you put your prayer in or you make your confession, put that little coin in the slot, pull the lever, and down comes the blessings. That's not how this works. Neither is it all man, where, you know, you've heard that old saying, God helps those who help themselves. You better get moving, you know. Right? Some of us have heard that. Oh, well, I guess God's not going to do anything. I better get to work and make this happen and then call it God afterwards. No, that's in the flesh. Abraham tried that. You remember with Ishmael. God says, no, it's not going to be according to the natural seed. So God wants a partnership with us. God wants it to be 100% God and 100% us. Us and him and him and us. Just like Jesus, right? Jesus came to show us the example of what perfect living would look like. And Jesus came and he was all God, and yet he was all man. We say, well, I don't understand that. That's a paradox. How can that be? And yet it is a paradox. It is both true equally at the same time. So now in our lives, there's a beautiful partnership that can take place where we believe God, where we work with God, and God works with us, and it gets the job done together. So what is our part in the promise? A couple of things that we're going to take a look at today. What is our part? See, God's going to do his part. We've got to do our part. So what's our part? If we're going to live this life, if we're going to do this, if we're going to get a hold of the promise of God, how do we do it? What is our part in the promise? First thing is this, faith. Right off the bat, we've got to believe God. Here's the paradox of faith. God brings the great from the small. That's the paradox of our faith. God brings great things out of small things. See, mere means can do nothing without God, but God will do nothing without faith. I've heard it said that Smith Wigglesworth said that God will leap over 100 men to find one that's in faith. See, God is looking for faith on the earth. Jesus said, will the Son of Man find faith when he comes? God is looking for us to believe him for something. God says he wants us to be in faith. See, faith hears the word and considers the source, not the circumstance. Let me say that again. Faith hears the word and considers the source and not the circumstance. Remember, she judged him faithful who had promised. Abraham considered him that what he had promised he was also able to perform. In your life, you're going to look around and you're going to say, it can't happen. I can't restore my family. I can't mend this marriage. I can't make enough money. I can't do it. And yet I've got a promise from God. See, you've got to have a promise first. You got to get a hold of the word of God. If you can see it in here, then you can believe it in here. Come on. See, but you can't believe God for something that's outside of this. You say, you mean, like, I never see socks in the Bible. That mean I can't believe God for socks? No, you can believe God for provision, right? You see that in the Bible. Okay, let's not be foolish. But what if, you know, someone once said, you know, I'm believing God for that man over there. And that man was married. No, you cannot believe God for that. All right, that's outside of his word. In fact, what's inside of the word about that, you're wrong. You better watch out. But if you're believing God for a godly marriage, hey, now you can believe God for that. That God brought Adam the woman, right? He was sleeping. And God pulled him out of his side and brought her to him. See, you can believe God for the promise of God. God, I'm just going to trust you. God, I'm going to believe you, Lord. And I know that you're going to bring it to pass. Why? Because I see it in your word. And God, in the natural, I don't see it. In the natural, I don't know how it's going to work out. And yet, I know, God, that you're able. See, that's faith. When you believe God at his word and trust him based on who he is. See, it only took a man and a woman to hear God's promise and judge him faithful for him to go to work and to make a nation. Jesus talks about the same paradox in Matthew, the 17th chapter. Turn there with me. Matthew, the 17th chapter, first book in the New Testament, Gospel of Matthew, chapter 17. The disciples come to Jesus. They're having a problem. They're saying, Jesus, you know, we came and we're trying to cast this devil out, and it won't come out. And yet you come along, and you cast it right out. Why couldn't we do it, Jesus? Jesus responds to them in verse number 20, Matthew, the 17th chapter. Take a look at what he says. So Jesus said to them, because of your unbelief. So you guys didn't have faith in this area, and it was because of your unbelief. For assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed. Now, in order to understand this, we've got to go to another section of Scripture that talks about the mustard seed. You remember the parable of the mustard seed. Jesus said that the word of God is like a mustard seed. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed that a man takes and he sows it into his garden. And even though it's the least of all the seeds of the garden, a teeny tiny little seed, right? You could mistake it for a grain of sand. In fact, one day I was walking with one and I had it in my hand and it fell out and it was gone, right? Because it's so little, you just don't even know where it went. It'll blend right in with the sand and the things that are around you. And so he says, you take this teeny tiny little seed, you plant it in the garden, and it grows up to become the greatest of all the herbs. Or he says it becomes a great tree where the birds of the air come and nest in its branches. Now that's a supernatural thing that takes place, right? Because that mustard seed is teeny tiny little things, and yet when you plant it in the garden, it becomes this great mighty thing. So Jesus says, it's because of your unbelief. For assuredly, I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, what does that mean? A teeny tiny little bit of faith. God takes small things and makes great things out of them. God took an old man and an old woman who were past the age of childbearing and made them the father and the mother of many nations. In the same way, it's no different with us. You don't have to have this outlandish faith. You don't have to be spitting and sweating and veins popping out. Everybody know, oh, look at that giant of faith over there. No, all you have to have is just a little bit of faith that says, I believe that God is able. I believe that God can do it. I believe that God will come to pass in my life. I know that God's word is true. I know that I can stand on the promises. That's all you got to have, just a little bit of mustard seed faith. And look at what he says. You will say to this mountain. Now, I picture Jesus with the disciples, and he's going, you'll say to this mountain, right? Maybe we should all go walk out in the parking lot and go take a look at San Gregorio Mountain over there. What do you think? Picture that in your mind. You'll say to this mountain, you say, but wait a second, it's too big. I don't think that can really happen. And yet Jesus is saying, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you'll say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. My question for you today is, what is the mountain that you're facing? What is the thing that you're looking up at that looks bigger to you than God looks right now? What is that problem that's shadowing over you, that's towering over you and looks like it's impossible? Jesus says, I want you to walk up to the base of that mountain. I want you to take a good, square look at that mountain, and I want you to take a look at the promise of God. And if you have a little bit of faith, if all you've got is a promise, if all you've got is a verse, if all you've got is a word, and you can believe God for it, then you can speak to that mountain, and you can say, mountain, move, and it will get up, and it will do what you say. Why? Nothing will be impossible for you. That's the word of God. You can speak to your mountains. Some of you in this place have mountains of financial debt that you're facing right now. You know, you can get a hold of a promise of God that my God shall supply all my need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And you can speak to that financial mountain, move, and it will move. Some of you are looking at your marriage, and that is an insurmountable mountain to you right now. And you're looking at a broken home and a broken marriage, and you're saying, I don't even know what to do. But you can get a hold of the promise of God, open up Ephesians, the fifth chapter, and start to declare the promise of God. I love that man like Christ loved the church. I love that woman, and I'm laying my life down like Christ did for the church. I'm going to submit to him as the church is subject to Christ in all things. I'm going to love her, and I'm going to lay down my life. I'm going to nourish her and cherish her. You can start to declare the promise of God over your life, and it will come to pass. See, unbelief is barren. As long as you don't believe God, you're never going to be able to cast it out. Come on. Disciples, these are guys that walked with Jesus, saw the miracles, and yet they couldn't cast it out. And Jesus says, because you're not believing me. It's because of your unbelief. Unbelief is barren, but faith is fruitful. When you believe God, it will produce fruit in your life. What is our part in the promise? First thing is this, faith. Second thing for us today is this. What is our part in the promise? Not only faith, but then comes labor. I got mighty quiet in this church. I only got one holy amen in the place. Wait a second, Pastor Dan, you said I got to work? Nah, I don't want to do that. But oftentimes we miss opportunities. There's a quote that says we oftentimes miss opportunities because it's dressed up like work. Nope, wearing overalls. I don't want to go there. We've got a tool belt? Mm-mm, nah, not smart enough to do that. And yet, remember, this is a partnership. God does all, we do all. We believe God, we speak the promises, and then we go to work and do what we need to do. Now, can we be mature in this place for a second? Okay, and hopefully your children are over there in the children's ministry. We got the greatest children's ministry on the planet for them, okay? So for those of you that are in the family rooms are pretty full, okay? I won't get graphic, but let's be mature about this for a second. And you guys need to start getting your kids over there if they're not sick. Get them in the children's ministry because they're going to get blessed. They're going to get the word of God on their level. For us, this is adult church, okay? Now, Abraham and Sarah, in order to have a baby, you see where I'm going with this? Couldn't just believe the promise of God. They could confess it. They could praise. But until they got together, ain't no babies being made. Hello? Okay? There is a part we have to play in the promise. We can receive the word of God. We can hear the word of God. We can confess the word of God. We can speak to that mountain, but then you got to go to work and get a shovel and start moving some dirt. Do what you got to do. Do your part in the promise. Some people are saying, well, I'm believing God for a job. That's great. How many applications have you put in? None. What do you think? They're just going to call you up, ring, hello. Yeah, we're with such and such a company, and we just had a vision from God. Your number just magically appeared on our computer screens with a little halo around it, and we just thought we would call you and see if you were looking for a job. Oh, you are? That's amazing. We're going to give you all the money you want. That's not going to work. You got to go beat the street, start knocking on doors, put in applications, dress up nice, make sure that they know that you're not a slob. Show up at the same time every day, bug the manager, get to know their name. Hey, is Jerry here today? What do you mean Jerry's hiding in the back? Hey, Jerry, I'm back again. Give me a job, bro. You might want to lose the bro, right? Sir, I'll work hard for you. Let me clean up that trash on my way out. Jerry, I care about this place. But you got to do your part. You want to have a great marriage? Start confessing the word of God. Start believing the promise. But then you better be nice. Start loving that woman. Start cleaning up around the house. When you come home, say hi. Put your shoes away where they go. Not just drop them on the floor and expect her to go get them. How about you help out with some dishes after dinner, right? Come on now. Ladies, you want that man to be a man of God? Okay, start living 1 Peter chapter 3. Okay, start submitting to him, reverencing him, respecting him. Honey, I'm so respectful of how you treat our family. The fact that you go and you work so hard. Now, ladies are saying, well, I work hard too. Yeah, you do. That's cool. But remember, love to a woman is what takes her up here. Respect to a man what takes him up here. He knows you love him because you showed up the next morning, right? You're still there after all these years of marriage. She loves me. She's still at home, right? But men are looking for respect. So even though you may have worked hard, if you say, honey, I respect how you work. Oh, lady. Well, let me work harder for you. What needs fixing around the house? I need to go take it. Honey, I heard a squeak over on that door. I'm going to go get some WD-40. I'll be right back. Right? All because of respect. See, you got to start doing your part. Whatever your part is to play. If you're believing God to get off drugs, stop hanging around them people that are supplying you with the drugs. Right? Cut that thing off. Believing God to stop drinking, stop going to the bar. Doesn't that make sense? I'm believing God to stop smoking. Well, stop going to the convenience store. What are you doing? Oh, I'm just looking for a Snickers bar. No, you're not. You're checking out, do I want red? Do I want green? What do I want today? No, get out of there. Start doing your part. Believing God to get off pornography? Time to give your wife the password, gentlemen. Can we talk? How about this? Get rid of the smartphone and get a dumb phone so that you're not tempted to go there anymore. It's too accessible. Your natural, with God's super on it, makes a supernatural experience in your life. Not going to happen unless you put in the effort. Unless you get to work on it. Genesis chapter 26, there's a famine in the land. Isaac is there. And take a look at what Isaac does in Genesis chapter 26, verse number 12. I'll put it up on the overhead. Then Isaac sowed in that land. What did he do? He went to work. Even when he could not see the results in the natural, even when the circumstances around him didn't look like anything was going to take place, Isaac sowed and look at it, and reaped. Did you know that reaping is work? We often think of reaping as, oh, I'm reaping the blessings. Oh, it's coming in, and we're dancing, and we're doing a jig, and oh, my goodness, all money and blessings and joy and all that kind of stuff. No, reaping is work. In fact, if you think about it, I know there's probably not too many farmers in the place today. There might be some of you guys that work in the agricultural area, but reaping is actually more work than sowing. Come on. Think about that for a second. You got acres and acres of plants. Now, to put that plant in the ground, it's just, right? Here's a seed, here's a seed, here's a seed. That plant grows up, and now you're going to reap. What do you got to do? You got to pluck it off. You got to put it in the thing. You got to wash it. You got to take it. You got to sell it. Reaping is actually more work than sowing. So here in a land of famine, Isaac sowed in that land, and he reaped in the same year 100-fold. That's quite a blessing. Especially in a famished land, he should have reaped nothing because the land was barren. And yet he didn't look at the natural circumstances. He believed God for something. He went to work on it, and he reaped 100-fold. Why? Because the Lord blessed him. In our lives, it's no different. God will bless what you put your hand to, but you have to put your hand to something. We must do what we can do, and then God will do what he can do. So the question for us today is, what is our part in the process? Not only what is my mountain, now that I've seen my mountain, now that I've confronted it, now that I'm believing God and I got a promise, what can I do? What is my part in this, God? What is my thing? Now listen, with a shovel at the base of a mountain, you're not going to be able to do much, but you can do something. Come on. I'm reminded of a little boy on the seashore. A bunch of starfish had washed up, right? Hundreds of them all the way across. And here he is, and he picks up these starfish, and he's throwing them back in the ocean. And a man comes walking up, and he says, what are you doing? He says, I'm saving lives right now. I'm taking these starfish and throwing them back in. He said, do you see how many hundreds of them? You could stay here all day, and it won't make a difference. And the kid picked up a starfish, looked at the man, threw it back in the water. He said, it made a difference to that one. What's your part? What's your part in the process? When you do, God will bless the rest. Which brings us to the last one. Not only what is our part in the promise? Number one, faith. Number two, labor. Last one for today is this, rest. When you have done all that you can do, then you rest in God who can do more than you can do. The paradox of rest is this, is that God brings life from death. Remember, God can make something out of nothing. He can take the small and make it great. But our God is a God of the resurrection. Our God is a God who takes dead things like Abraham's body and Sarah's womb, and he can bring resurrection life out of them, right? You think about it. We see this in their lives. Abraham was as good as dead, and Sarah's womb was past the age of childbearing. Her womb was dead. In the natural, it wasn't going to work out. But that didn't stop God. He brings forth life from death. Jesus weighed in on this as well. You there? Turn with me to the book of John this time. John, if you're in Matthew or Genesis, turn with me to the book of John now. John chapter number 12. And in fact, if you read John chapter number 12, you'll find a lot of paradoxes of the Christian life. And in John chapter number 12, Jesus is talking about how he's going to be crucified, how he's going to die, how he's going to be buried, and then raised again to life. And look at what he says in verse number 24. John chapter 12, verse 24, Jesus says this, "Most assuredly I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and," what's that word right there? Oh, come on, there's a lot more than 20 people in the room today. What is that word right there? Dies. He says it remains alone. Think about this for a second. If you had a seed packet, right? You ripped open the top of that seed packet and you placed it on your countertop. Next day you could come back. Next week you could come back. Next month you could come back. And it will never be like where you start to just pour that out and carrots just come tumbling out of there, right? See, if you leave the seed alone, it will remain alone. But the moment you take that little seed and you plant it in the ground and you cover it up. See, God is giving us pictures in the natural of things that happen in the spirit. Some things have to rest. Some things have to die. When you have done your part, you have planted the seed and you have covered it up and you have done everything that you can do. You've watered it. You put it in a good place in the sun. Now you've got all the right conditions. You've conditioned the soil. But listen, you cannot make that seed have any life or any power in itself. God is the one who takes that dead thing in the ground, and God is the one who raises it up and causes it to be fruitful. So Jesus says, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. See, in order for there to be a resurrection, there has to first be a death. And in order for us in our lives to receive the results of God, we have to rest from our labors. We believed God, we've spoken the promise, we've prayed it, we've thanked God for it, we've done everything that we can do in the natural, and now we have to leave it to God, and God will bring forth the results. That's what this is all about, church. There must first be a death before there can ever be a resurrection. Once there's rest on our part, there can be a result on God's part. That's the paradox of faith. We leave it in his hands. Some of you guys have been wondering, how come it hasn't come to pass? How come God's not moving? How come God's not doing? And listen, you might be working in the natural, and God is saying it's not according to the flesh. Not by might, not by power, by my spirit, says the Lord. God says, I'll do it. Some of you guys need to stop. Some of you guys need to release your grip on it and say, God, I'm giving it to you. God, I've done everything that I can do, and I don't know anything else to do, so God, I'm just placing it in your hands. God, I've prayed. God, I've confessed. God, I've gone after it. God, I've talked to them. God, I've said my peace. Lord, I have witnessed to them, Lord, and I prayed for their salvation, but God, I'm leaving them in your hands now. And now watch what God does. God is the one who will bring life out of a dead situation. Don't look at the circumstances. Lift your eyes. Don't look at what's taking place all around you. It'll be uncertain. You won't know how it's going to happen. And yet, don't consider the circumstances. Consider the one who promised. He will bring it to pass. Leave it in his hands. Let's end with this. Deuteronomy chapter 7. Turn there with me. Fifth book of the Bible. Last scripture for today. Deuteronomy chapter number 7. God says that it's by faith that when we believe God and we do our part, he will do his part. We can rest in him. God is the one who takes small things and makes them great things. He makes something out of nothing. God is the one who brings life out of death. Isn't it like God to choose a church like ours in a bankrupt city? In a place that's called the armpit of Southern California. To raise up a great church like this and make something out of nothing. To take broken people like each and every one of us. You know, this is church, it's oftentimes called the church of the exes. It seems like most of the people that I meet are telling me, yeah, I just got out. Or I've had a broken marriage. Or you should have known me before I got saved. See, we're all ex-somethings in here. Ex-perverts, ex-drug addicts, ex-cons, ex-something. And yet God takes broken things and he makes something out of nothings. And he brings life out of death. And it's all because of who he is and what he's done. It's not because of us. Look at verse 7 of Deuteronomy chapter 7. It says, "The Lord did not set his love on you, nor choose you, because you were more in number than any other people. For you were the least of all the peoples." God chooses the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. He chooses the base things and the weak things to bring low the haughty and the mighty. Look at verse number 8. Why does he do it? This is why. "But because the Lord loves you, and because he would keep the oath which he swore to your fathers, the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of bondage, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt." Two things, two reasons why God does this. Number one, because he loves us so much. And number two, because God has promised in his word. What's our part in the promise? Three things that we learned today. Number one, faith. We got to believe God, get a hold of the word of God. And God is a God who will take our faith and make something out of nothing. Secondly, we got to go to work on it. We got to work hard and do our part, whatever we can do. And then finally, we've got to rest. Leave it with him, because our God is a God of resurrection power. He will bring life out of death. Did you guys get something from the word today? Come on, let's give God a great big praise. Hallelujah. I could feel you learning and drawing on the anointing. And yet, it'd be a tragedy if we did all that and you felt like, man, I had such a great time in church. You walked out to your car and you turned on your car. Your heart turned off. You died. You ended up going to hell rather than going to heaven. That would be a tragedy. Let me talk to you about your life and where you're at with God before you leave this place. Sometimes people hear that term hell and they say, well, that offends me, Pastor. I don't really like that term. I don't like the idea of that. That means that God is mean and hateful and sending people to hell. And I don't believe that God is a God like, you know, some people say he is in the Old Testament, where he's vengeful and all that kind of stuff. And I think that God, you know, isn't Jesus go to the cross so that everybody could go to heaven, you know? And yet hell is a very real place. It's not just a fairy tale made up by people. This is something that the Bible talks about in the Old and the New Testament. Jesus himself spoke about it. God warns us about hell. God is not pleased when people go to hell. It grieves his heart. And that's why we're all still here, is because God is waiting patiently, not willing that any should perish. God loves us so much that he didn't want us to go to hell. And yet he loves us enough to give us the free will choice while we're here on the earth. We get to choose with our time here on the planet where we go, whether we go to heaven or whether we go to hell. And not all roads lead to heaven, contrary to what some would have us to believe. Some people say, oh, well, the way is wide and it's open and everybody gets to go. You know, you just do your thing, I'll do my thing. The church is out there, they can do whatever they want to. God sees that and appreciates that. He's going to let us into heaven just because all roads lead to heaven. But I don't see that in the Bible. You know, that's like saying on earth, all roads lead to the moon. You can drive around the earth as long as you want and you will never make it. So what makes us think that we can make it to heaven just doing whatever we want to do? In fact, if you read your Bible, the Bible says that the way to heaven is narrow and there are few who find it. And yet the path to destruction is wide and open, and there are many who are on it. Today, I want to give you some direction for the Word of God. How do we get there? Because don't you think God, creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption and carried it out in his son Jesus, don't you think that after he goes to the cross, a beaten, bloody mess, buried in the ground and raised again, don't you think that he would let us know how to get to heaven? Well, he does right here in his word. Sometimes people hear that and they say, Pastor, that's good news because, you know, I know God lets good people into heaven. I've been a really good person. Yeah, I used to be bad, but I've cleaned up my act and I've been really good lately. I haven't knocked over 7-Eleven in quite some time. And so, you know, I've been working on my resume, Pastor. I've been doing a lot of good deeds, giving money to charities, helping people out, being nice to my neighbors. And you know, I think that finally, I've tipped the scales and my good outweighs my bad. I think that God's going to see that and let me into heaven because I've been good. But did you know that the problem with that is that nowhere in the Bible does it say how good you have to be in order to get to heaven? There's no grading scale, no curve, no line you have to be above, behind the map section that says be this good, or, you know, there's no chart. If you do this much good or your good outweighs your bad, you get to go to heaven. It doesn't work like that. In fact, the Bible tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. There's not one who is perfect except one. His name is Jesus. And our goodness compared to God's goodness, like filthy rags, the Bible says. Not going to get to stay. They're going to get thrown out. Today, let's talk about your life. Some of you in this place said, well, you know, Pastor, not only have been I good, but, you know, I've been raised in church. Parents told me we were Christians growing up. took me to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class, hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child. You're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians, headed for heaven, denying our presence in hell, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents raised you in church, tell you you're Christian, that makes you a Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you wear religious jewelry, attend religious classes, be baptized or christened as a child, or because you're born in America that you get to go to heaven. And I don't see anywhere in the Bible that says that because you're not some other religion, that by default, God lumps you in the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven and denying hell. Come on, let's talk about your life. Let's make sure before you leave this place that your heart is right with God. You say, but Pastor, okay, I get that, but not only when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church right now, and I consider myself to be a Christian. And while that's great, and I'm glad you're here today, show that to me in the Bible where you sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. That's like me saying, you know what, I've decided to become a Dodger. And I go down to the sports store, I buy a Dodger uniform, put it on, drive down to Los Angeles, bring my bat and my ball, sit in the dugout, call myself a Dodger, and think that I'm going to get to play in the game. You know what's going to happen? They're going to find me sitting there, drag me out, and lock me up. Why? Because I am not a member of the Dodgers organization. I don't belong there. Same way, you can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, and that makes you a Christian. You say, but Pastor, hold on a second, because my last church, I got involved. I helped out. I carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. Sang in the choir for a number of years, taught in the Bible class. I even got a membership card to that church. Doesn't that count for something? Well, yeah, once again, we're back to good works. But God is not looking for your volunteer hours, looking to see whether or not you sang in a choir, taught in the Bible classes before you can enter the gates of heaven. God is not looking for your membership card to a church to qualify for heaven. It doesn't work like that. Now, some of you might be thinking, well, Pastor, I got you on this one. I know God. Somebody told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I get to go to heaven. I know about Jesus, celebrate the resurrection at Easter, sing the songs at Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor, Old and New Testament. I know God. Well, that's great, but if you'd read your Bible, you know the demons know who Jesus is. They're not Christians. The devil himself knows and believes that Jesus Christ is Son of God and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here, me for a second, look up here. This is not about what you have in your head, having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God, headed for heaven and denying hell. But rather, this is about your heart. God is looking for your heart. Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, I know a lot of times we hear that term being born again and we turn off. We say, ugh, I saw that in a movie or I read about that, you know, and I just really don't like that term and I don't want to be associated with that. And yet, if you're not born again, you're not going to make it. Because Jesus said, unless you be born again, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. John, the third chapter. So what does being born again really mean then? Does it mean what Hollywood says or movies or books or television or the internet? No, it means what the Bible says it means. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot. Or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he talking about? Lukewarm, what's that? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again. And occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity. Jesus said these words. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. In a moment, here's your opportunity. I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. And when I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang. Now, when you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, Pastor, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up, I'll count it, you can put it right back down. Now you might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be embarrassed. Let's get over that today. Well, I could think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. And yet the devil thinks you're so dumb, he's trying to talk you out of it. Oh, no, don't do this right now. This is just fanaticism. This is just emotions. You don't need to do this. But listen, you tell that devil, go jump in a fiery lake. You're going on with God today, securing your future with God forever and ever in eternity with him in heaven, giving God all of your heart and all of your life. Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. And this is safe and friendly church service. And Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'm a man. I'll see your hand go up, count it. You can put it right back down, okay? But he said, if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. I've done my job. I've loved you enough to tell you the truth. God's already done his job, sending Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross. Now it's your turn. Remember, this is a partnership. God has offered. God has opened the way. God has shown you the way now, and now it's your turn. Will you put in your effort? Will you acknowledge your need for Jesus by simply raising your hand in this safe and friendly place? Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today's your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus? Come on, I'm speaking to you. Finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, raise your hand. God sees, and then you can tell an usher right afterwards or come back into the church service. Online, across the nation and around the world. If you're ready to do this, you can lift your hand. Distance doesn't matter. God sees you. God's with you right now and is excited about your future. You can raise your hand, and then right afterwards, minimize your browser, and there's a blue button that says respond to God. Someone will lead you in a prayer right where you're at, or you can go to our homepage and click the button that says how to know God at rockchurch.com. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Get ready to get your hands up. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now if that's you. Thank you. There's one, two, three, four, five, six. Thank you. You've got two hands up. I'll count them twice. Seven. Praise the Lord. Up there, eight, nine, ten. Got you over there. 11 right up front here. Thank you. God bless you. 11, 12. Got you over there. Thank you on this side. 13 up top. Got you over there. 13 wise people already. Anybody? Wait, so all the people that need to get saved sat on this side today, I guess. Where are you at on this side over here? Someone up there? 12 or 13 wise people? Out there in the foyer, is there somebody? How many? Two in the foyer. All right, 13, 14, 15. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? 15, 16, I got you right there. Thank you. You can put your hand down. 16 wise people already. Anybody else real quick? 17 up top over there. Got you. God bless you. Anybody else real quick over there? Thank you. Thank you. I see you right there. God bless you. 17, 18. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? I want to give you just a moment. Check yourself out. You know, if your heart's pounding out of your chest and you're wondering if you should, you should. Got you up there. Thank you. Is there two more up there, Tom? Oh, two. Praise God. 19 and 20. God bless you. Anybody else real quick? About 20 wise people. If you need to join them today, if that's you. 20, 21. Got you up there. Thank you. Anybody else? Last call. I'm going to wrap this thing up. Come on, let's go for God today if that's you. Didn't embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about 21 wise people. Hallelujah. So good, so good, so good. All right, all 21 of you, or if you're number 22, you rascal, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late, all right? In a moment, we're all going to stand, give a clap, and sing a song. As we do that, that's your cue. Get your stuff. Whatever you brought with you to church, your purse, Bible, get a friend if you need a friend, all right? And once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that until we get you down here. So if that's you, you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand. Come on, let's welcome them. Let's all stand. And you come right now. Come on down.
Amazing love, how can
they're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. From the family rooms, you can bring your children. Come on, they're welcome right now. They'll remember this. Bring them on down. From the foyer, if you raised your hand, come on in. They're still coming.
Amazing love, how can be?
They're still coming. Come on, we'll wait for you. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. Anybody else, if you need to come, come on, number 22, number 23, number 24, number 25, you've been waiting, this is your time, just move out of your seat, get in the aisle and meet us up front right now, come on down, come on down, they're still coming, Hallelujah. They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. Wow. Thank God you guys have come. Hey, everybody up front. Remember this? Do it. All right? Put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. Okay? Came to give God all of your heart. Came to give God all of your life. Right over here to my right, your left. This guy waving at you in the tie. Looking good over here. This is Reverend Antonio. Okay? You can call him Reverend Tony if you like. He's a good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. Sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Listen, you already got past me. All right? I'm about as weird as you're going to encounter today. He's cool. He's going to do three things. First thing he's going to do is lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again. Okay? Second thing he's going to do, he's going to give you some free information and some free literature to find out, now that I'm a Christian, what do I do next? Okay? Then he's going to introduce you to a program we have here called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Basically, it's a friend in church who'll come alongside you for 5 weeks, teach you 5 things out of the Bible, help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. Okay? Then right after he's done with all that, he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you, all right? So if you guys will make a left turn and follow Reverend Antonio right this way, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.